welcome back. Another day, another vlog. Hope you're well.
Oh, what have I done?
There we go. Too much power in that epidemic music. Wowee. Hey guys, how are you? Let me turn it down here a bit. There we go. Sorry I missed you last night. Had a big day out filming, getting a heap of stuff for one of the new videos, which I'll be going to be doing this swing. I've got three I want to get out this swing, so going to be pretty busy. So yeah, I spent a bit more time getting that ready. I was out testing the new gimbal from Siri as well, which is one of them. I've got the, I tried to get some more to finish off my macro. I'm just not happy with that. So I'm not going to put that out until I can get what I need to finish. Hopefully I can find some stuff this swing to get photos of, to finish that series off and that lens to get a bit more on that, to do it justice. Did a heap of stuff with the 8 blade Super Takumar 50mm, so that was pretty cool. As well as, talked about the gimbal, and we did Mundaring Dam. So, got a heap of stuff there. I just need to get in there, get that editing mode on like I had last swing and smash a heap out. And so heaps of content coming up for you in the next couple of weeks, hopefully to Christmas. You get a bit of time home, a couple of red wines, have a few for me. I won't be drinking for the next 2 weeks. So yeah, you get that every couple of years. Basically you do a year on, year off. 1 year you miss Christmas, the next year you sort of have time with your family. That's sort of the fair way to do it in mining. That's generally how it happens. Some people cheat the system and just take it off every year. Not much you can do. Just take the good with the bad. I try to keep it fair because I know what it's like when I get to be with my lad. Hopefully next year we'll be in a new house in a new state, so it'll be really exciting for him. And he'll be over three then, so he'll be really ready for Santa and all that stuff. But yeah, so we've got a bit to do. Obviously I missed yesterday, my apologies about that. By the time I got home, I had to pack my bags, book in, get all the stuff done. I wanted to spend the last night with Jack and my amazing wife. I don't get enough time with them as is, so my apologies, but I'm back today with a vengeance. Kick back, relax, we got a bit of stuff to talk about. Sorry about my voice, is a bit blur. Get a drink of water. JBL. Water, it's awesome. It's a great invention, that one. Wish I had the patent on that. JBL solar powered wireless headphones. We've all seen the Beats Pro, the little plastic suckers. Well, basically they put a solar panel in the top of that. That will give you, if you leave that out in the sun, or if you're wearing it, like most people do, they wear it while they're walking around. If you've got a sunny day and you've got that over on your head or walking around, and it will power under normal lights, like fluoros and indoor lights, for 90 minutes, they're saying that will last you 3 days. It also comes with a USB cord if that isn't enough, or you need a quick boost if you've smashed it out or whatever. They're saying it's gonna be coming out October next year. So perfect timing for next year's Christmas gift, and it's probably, we're already not even at Christmas, we're still thinking about next year. But seems pretty interesting in a day when everything's wireless. Charging is, I guess, the main issue that people are concerned about, or they've got to know how long it takes to charge. We're talking about 15-minute recharges and 10-minute recharges for phones. Now we're talking about full wireless headphones. Wireless headphones are pretty amazing. I got a good set I go running with, a pair of Monsters, which I love. I've had them for, I think, 5 or 6 years, and they haven't missed a beat, so I haven't have to even worry about changing them. Occasionally they'll break up when I'm running the Bluetooth, but I think that's more so Bluetooth than the actual product. Bluetooth itself, that old, I think we're on the old model on that. I think it's 3 or 4.0 or whatever it was, is not the best Bluetooth. Same as my Apple Watch Series 1, it's just bloody woeful now when you can compare it to the new stuff. So, but yeah, pretty cool. Little solar power in the band. Excuse me, throat's terrible. So yeah, looking forward to that. They're good. I'm not sure if they're doing JBL. I think they're just going to bring them out. So keep your eye out. If you are a JBL fan, that's going to be something to definitely look at. And just guys who just use headphones all day, every day, when they're traveling on trains and stuff like that, this would be a perfect one for you, so without having to worry about charging the stuff. The Motorola Razr was unboxed. The boys at Unbox Therapy, I'm a big fan of Lou and Willie D. They do a great job. I enjoy watching when they talk about the products, what they talk about. They got the Motorola today or yesterday, and what a nice bit of kit. I never had the Motorola Flips when they come out. I was a Sony Ericsson phone. You either were basically Motorola, BlackBerry, Nokia, or Sony Ericsson. I love the Sony Ericsson, and I wouldn't use the Nokia. I hated the Nokia. I just didn't like the buttons, and the Sony Ericsson to me was easy to get the phone numbers. So I never had the original Flip, but seeing this thing, wow, what a good looking phone. It's just, I'm sorry, but excuse my language, pardon my French, shits all over that Samsung Fold. Holy crap, that looks just such a better form factor. My personal opinion, of course. The Fold, Galaxy Fold, you open it up, but when you got it, it's like having a friggin' Zupa Duper or a lollipop. Where this is a good, it fits in the hand, it's solid. Probably about the thickness of the mouse. Good thickness, and it's got that, as Lou said, it's got that flick. That flick, and you used to see all the, and by the end you had a bit of a wrist movement where you could flick it open without even pushing it, you could flick it, and I'm sure that's going to be the same. How that's going to affect the screen quality and how long that lasts will be something to, I guess we'll find out in the next 6 months. But looks amazing, really really good, decent speakers on it, well weighted, they're saying, so the screen looked good. The only concern he had was the fact that when you went into a horizontal format to say look at a movie, you had to, I guess, zoom in because, and understandably, most footage that's put up on either YouTube or whatever, they're not in the right ratio. I think it's 13 to, I don't even know. I'm not going to sit here and lie to you. I can't remember. But he did say it today, but just the different ratio. So he went to one of his YouTube videos and he had to just expand it out, and because it's just that extra longer. I guess it's like a widescreen format. So it'd be good for anamorphic stuff. So that'd be pretty cool. So yeah, definitely something to check out for the money you're going to have to pay for it. It's obviously big bucks. But if you're willing to spend that money, this is one primo bit of gear that is going to stand out in a crowd, which is exactly what you want. And form features and all that stuff. It does have a lower end processor in it. Just be aware of that. Like, the tech specs on it aren't as good as, say, the Samsung Fold. But like, use, pocketability, size, flick. It's got everything else you can imagine, and I think it's going to do very, very well. And it'll be good to see once the Samsung Flip, the copy comes out, and see what they put in that to fight Motorola. I'd say you'll see we're going to have a different screen set up, so I don't know how good that'll be because that screen is really awesomely done. But they may have the better tech specs to fight it. So it's going to be a really good market, that Fold. I think that's going to be better than the horizontal. Myself, my personal opinion again, but yeah, I think so. YouTube, Coppa. Still happening out there. Oh, goodness me. I watched the video and I watched it through, and I don't know if I'm just a dumb ass, but it's still, they just made it more confusing. YouTube, they come out with another video saying that basically, yeah, where we said it wasn't, or basically when we said there was, it was anything cartoons was going to be kids, now it's, well no, not everything will be cartoons. And I'm like, okay, so before at least there was a definition that anything that sort of appealed to kids was basically going to possibly could get hit by this USA government agency. So only one country in the world is now deciding what everyone on the planet can watch and do. That's A, and that in itself is scary enough that they have that much control. And that's pretty piss poor, I think. If they're that concerned about children, why don't they form a global media, child media protection unit that handles these international things? That's what my thoughts are, instead of just the USA picking and deciding what isn't good enough for anyone. But just grey areas, like it's... So now you can have cartoons, but if they're not directed towards a child, well, no, that's okay. But depends. And I'm like, what? I'd literally watched a video and just said, that just made it worse, because now you've said everything you said before that no, it was no good. Now you're saying, yeah, that's okay, but it's all on your shoes. It's up to you to decide. But Coppa's the one that is going to smash her. The FTC is the one that's going to smash her. YouTube's not going to get in trouble. You're going to get in trouble because you're the one that picked, yeah, it's okay. They're very, very clear to let that bit out that, yeah, whatever we tell you, it doesn't matter because it's whatever the FTC thinks. So it's got nothing to do. So it's, look, I think it's just a really grey area. I think the FTC, and unfortunately, they're an American-based thing. They're not an Australian government thing. They're not a European agency. They're not an Asian agency. They're not a South American agency. They're not a Canadian. They're not a Mexican. All they are is USA. But somehow, this global YouTube platform is controlled by a US government agency. Well, hello, China, you're now running the USA. Isn't that what you get upset about, China, USA? You give them crap about how they spy on everyone and they use their government powers to run businesses. Wow. Now, as a parent, if I don't want my kid to watch something, he ain't watching it. It's simple. You don't let him watch it. Or what parent just lets their kid just go free for all and do whatever they want on the internet and that? Well, that's their parent's choice and that's their decision, and that's up to that parent. That's the parent's job. A free-to-air television has just a MR, like the warning things on your movies when you go to the movies. That's all the TV does. But the kids can still watch it. They just turn it on. They have things at certain times of the day. But how can YouTube can't do that, because there's different time zones it's running. So I think a lot of this comes back to parents just neglecting their fact that it's their responsibility to make these decisions. And if you give access to the internet to your child, then you are responsible of what selections that they can choose and teach them the right thing. And I've got a 2-year-old. I'm going to have to get through all this with him, but I know that's my responsibility. That's my job, not some other government, whatever, like far out. What are you going to do? Cancel all the religious groups because they're all sex? They're all, you know, they're all brainwashing. Are they brainwashing? Are we going to cancel everything that I don't believe in or someone else doesn't believe in just because that could affect that child? Where do you stop? I think this has got to be left more in the parents' hands, and these government agencies and do-gooders need just to back off and just mind their own business. But anyway, still a crap ton of copper grey, I'd say. I don't think anyone's none the wiser. I think we're just going to wait till January 1st, see what happens, and see who the poor sucker is that gets made example of. And I think that's basically what it's going to be. There's going to be clearly the fine guys that were like your channels that are testing toys and stuff for kids. They're going to cop a flogging and lose a shit ton of money. Unfortunately, looks like usually the guys that lose out. Too bad. YouTube doesn't really care about you. You get that. And then there's going to be the guys that are in that they might have something there that someone doesn't like. The next minute, they're going to lose a packet of money or end up in jail for not paying fines because they can't, because there's some small creator that's going to get smashed. So, yeah, look, I don't know. It's all I know is they keep YouTube keeps putting these stupid videos out, and the lady that's doing it, she's probably trying to get it right, but she's just making it sound even worse. And especially when you're crossing borders, you say tomato, I say tomato, and it just sounded like you really were just making it even worse, and it sounded worse. So yeah, just stop it. Wait till January 1 and let the people that are going to make decisions, FTC, that, and then YouTube better be getting in and backing their creators. They're the ones that make all the most of the money out of this. So if they should be in there supporting their creators and helping their creators against the FTC to work out what the problem is and get stuff fixed. It shouldn't be YouTube just going, nah, well, we told you so, it's not our problem, and just see you later. Stuff you, creator, we gave you a warning. Because that's what it sounds like. They should be going, look, it's going to happen January 1. Here's a bit of a guidelines. When it happens, if anything goes wrong, we're going to be there to support you. We're going to work with the FTC and our creators to make sure each case is dealt with fairly and our creators don't get poorly judged. That's what YouTube should be doing, not this bullshit ad campaign about it's all on you crap. How about washing your hands of us? Anyway, you get that. I don't make any money anyway, so I guess it's pretty easy for me to say, but it should be said. And it's just been dealt with just terribly by YouTube. Just they're on a worse run than Intel at the moment. Oh yeah. Right, let's get on some positive stuff. That was my blah for the day. SteadyXP for DSLR cameras, cinema cameras. We all know about GoPros and the DJ Osmo, Steadicam and Rocksteady. Doing a fantastic job. My GoPro 7 is friggin' awesome for stability. And they do that digitally. Inside that little camera, there's some magic man in there who does it. It's pretty darn cool what they do with that nowadays, and makes it a lot easier for us rookies to put out a decent bit of footage. Now, there's I believe it's a French company. Was a couple of French guys talking, so that's pretty bad. Yeah, I don't know where they're from. Let's just go with that. SteadyXP. Now, what they're trying to do, they've got this little box, and it basically sits on. How big would it be? Oh, it's not that big, eh? I'd say probably a little bit twice the size of that. That's my Canon battery. A little bit bigger than that, and it sits anywhere on your camera or your gimbal. And what it does, you plug the sound out of your mic into this, and then match it into your camera. And then what it does is, it matches the sound to the movements or something along those lines. It's sort of technical, matches the sound. And then what you do, you put that into post with their software. Bloody hell, I can't even speak. Throat's killing me. Yeah, anyway. It'll then take that, it match it up to your video clip. It will then either crop or steadily crop, and it comes up with a really good image. I'd say it's very similar to the technology of Rocksteady and the DJI software that does that. And you obviously do lose a touch of crop to get that smoothness. But the footage I watched on the video today was just fantastic. They've done a great job. Very, very cool. And for DSLRs that don't have in-body stabilisation, guys with your red cameras and all this, they had a veteran Steadicam operator there, and he's saying it was like a really good bit of tech. The company's in its infancy, so it's sort of just starting up. Excuse me. But looks like they're going to go really well, and once they get this nailed down, it's going to be a bit of a mainstay for that, and maybe something to think about so you don't need a gimbal. You might be able to run freelance with a camera with no gimbal on and just fix it in post. As long as you don't have, you can allow a little room for crop, that might be enough just to lets you get your stuff done. So very cool, SteadyXP. Go check that out. Now, lucky last, the Nissan Titan Ute. Big fan of the Nissan Titan Utes in America. There was talk a while ago about them shipping them to Saudi Arabia, so they're going to make a right-hand production line, and then that was a possibility to come to Australia. Well, the talks have opened up yet again with Nissan Australia about the possibility of bringing the Titans to Australia. The Ute market's got a lot bigger. The Chevy Silverado is doing well. The Dodge Ram's doing well here. A little bit in excess of your normal average person, but still, they're still selling in reasonable quantities. There's a mob called Promcar, which Nissan are talking to about giving them basically the contract to come in and do the transfers over to right-hand side. So I'm not sure what happened with Saudi Arabia and why that fell through, and that hasn't happened, because that was going to be a global right-hand drive production and just ship them straight in, basically. But yeah, so Promcar are looking into that, so fingers crossed we may have the Nissan Titan coming to Australia in the next year or 2 years. They reckon they've got the expansion range there in their facilities to do it, so it's something they can easily ramp up into and get it done. And they reckon they can do it for a lot less than other cars, so it should be cheaper than the Silverado and the Ram, even better. So possibly around the 70 to 80 mark would be a good ballpark. And that would go up against the Ford Raptor, which would be a huge, huge win for Titan, because you're definitely, with that V8, gorgeous leather seats all the way through, that'd be a fair old win for Nissan if you can get in that sort of ballpark. And that's about it. Another day, first day on site. Back to it, we're going through to Christmas. We're going through all the way, 13 days to go till New Year's, and then I get to go home. That's good. Another 2 weeks for 2019, we're done and dusted. Hope you got all your Christmas stuff done. I'll be with you for the rest of the next 2 weeks. If anything you need to know about, or you haven't seen, or need help with, drop us a question down below. Always happy to help. Yeah, that's what it's all about. That's why we're all here, to help each other learn stuff. That's what YouTube does for me, and I'm happy to, if I've got anything I can share with you guys, happy to share it on back. Thanks for stopping by. Hit that subscribe if you haven't been here before. If you don't mind, or you think it's okay, yeah, it's all good. If not, hit the thumbs down, thumbs up. I'm happy with either. Drop us some ideas of what you're after and what you need to know about as well. Happy to find that out for you too. And we'll see you all again tomorrow. So wherever you're coming, you're going. We'll see you all tomorrow. Ciao.